was a tree I saw in China, or a number of trees, and it was a particularly the spatial form within the trees and the kind of almost the human element of the kind of bodiliness of the trees, the forms that the trees had, and that was the thing that I found very interesting. It was within an area where there was a number of temples, so I think the tree had been manipulated or allowed to form itself in a certain way as an object of contemplation. And I suspect that this particular tree had been allowed, well, not allowed, but had grown in a particular way to capture these forms and act as a form of reverie as it walked around the tree. And it was this enclosure of forms, this spatial element, that I found completely fascinating. The origins were probably from this one particular tree that I'd done drawings from in China, but then as I worked on a number of trees, one tree manifested itself and changed and suggested another. So it's using elements, and again I come back to these kind of bodily elements of different joints and necks and torso.
The trees, when I first saw them, looked very much to me like dendritic patterns of growth, of branch-like tree shoots, but they're also very reminiscent of the human brain as well. When you're looking at those, tree patterns, you feel as though you're being absorbed into a mental space.
I think there's all elements of the self-portrait in the trees, certainly. Trees are particular to me, you know, the forms and, that they have, and just how they move, and how something crosses, how something touches, and how something is compacted or bent.
And then you follow the pattern of growth as one might follow the nerve centres in your brain. You're in a psychological space.
I think it's a subject. I mean, I always return to self-portraits, not from any narcissistic approach, but it's just more to use myself to be able to enter into and question myself. So use myself as a kind of format, really, for that. It's like these internal landscapes. You know, you exist in this particular world and it's your existence, and it's that questioning constantly of that existence and how you respond to that.
You could almost be inside somebody's head. It kind of grows the paintings. It begins with the stem, which might be the stem of one's nervous system, the neck. In this most recent body of the archives, the trees, I think he's taken this a step further. This psychic space has found another form of expression. Strange archive scenes, strange repositories of hidden information. We don't know what these files of information are in his paintings. You feel as though you are in a place that's full of information. You're in a kind of archive, but it's Tony's archive. It's Tony's inner world. It's his private space that you, just for a moment, inhabit, and you get a glimpse of something that's not quite within reach.
They almost formed like a cipher, like a secret language. So it's this whole notion of the way that the forms that the archives had was a particular language. That's what reignited really this interest in archives and libraries. The thing that fascinates me about charcoal is the fact that no two pieces are alike. Each has its own behaviour, and as a drawing material, it's that unpredictability that I like about it. When you're drawing, you might come to a knot that changes the whole behaviour of the line, and it allows things to happen. The pigments, they all origins from the earth, whether they're plants or metals, heavy metals, or some are from oil, a lot of the synthetics now are from oil. And again, they all have their own weights, and in that weight they have a behaviour. You'll get a pigment that's, cadmium, which is a very heavy nature, the kind of particles of the pigment very close together. And, you know, it has a kind of a weight that kind of sits on the canvas. These doors with things pinned on them, it just, they are like an aid for memory and kind of like thoughts and notes. And there's the shoes, which for me are, it's my calendar. It's really an aid for how long I've been in the studios here, which is some 24 years. And it's very difficult now to find very thin sole shoes. I like to feel the surface of the studio floor. You know, that's probably one of the main reasons I'm working on the floor too, painting, is I like that physical contact with the canvas, and you know, when I'm kneeling or standing on the canvas.
And what's extraordinary about Tony is that he does just that every day in the studio. He chooses to place himself in that predicament, a situation of having to concentrate on basically himself, and working with a motif, whether it's his own features or whether it's a drawing or some other starting point, he then begins the process of responding to his situation, and he fills his art with that response. And this, I think, is really the beginning of his art. And it's also the fabric of his work as well, a sense of his self, his own internal landscape, his own psyche. And I think it's a really remarkable body of work, and there's nothing else quite like it.